What's going on, adventurers? Vulcan here, and today we're diving into my personal tier list for weapons. So this was put together from my experience with each weapon and the level of potential it has throughout the game, from early game to mid game to end game. Now, there's no doubt in my mind that there will be some on here that you disagree with, but I would love to learn more. So please drop a comment below as to why a weapon needs to shift up or down. So let's go ahead and get this thing started with the S tier weapons. So to me, what qualifies as an S tier? This is a weapon that has minimal downsides. It's powerful and effective throughout the entire game from early, mid to end game. Choosing this weapon will almost always improve your combat effectiveness, your utility, and just make life way easier for you in New World. So that's an S tier. Let's go ahead and get started with our first one. And that should be to no surprise of anybody. It's the Hatchet. So the Hatchet is a weapon that was designed with hyper aggressive players in mind, but this is because it rewards constant attacks and it really has a place for most players. The Hatchet has two trees, a Berserker tree and a Throwing tree. Now the Berserker tree is easily the better of the two in my opinion, because I love the namesake skill, Berserk, and all of the abilities that come with it on a relatively short cooldown. You gain damage increases, movement speed increases, cleanses, health recovery. You gain all of this while Berserk is active, and it has a relatively short cooldown. And then to complement this skill, the tree comes with two like assault style abilities, Raging Torrent and Feral Rush. Both of these deal high slashing damage and they become more powerful as the enemy's health gets lower. So this tree also comes with a nice damage bonus as long as you land attacks. So in short, the Hatchet, it's all gas, no brakes. It works extremely well. And this has been a constant throughout all of the tests, the betas, the alphas, everything. The Hatchet is just one of those go-to weapons that has so much utility, so much survivability, range, and a ton of damage baked into it. It's hard to put it lower than S tier for now. So next, let's talk about the other one, right? If you have the Hatchet, the other weapon you have to talk about as an S tier is the Great Axe. This is a two-handed monstrosity and it's built to make life easy just for everyone. If you can left click, you can take care of almost anything that gets in your way. Now, I mean, that might be a little bit of an exaggeration, but in reality, that's kind of how this thing works. The Great Axe has incredibly high base damage and skills that will reward successful attacks on enemies. And all you have to do is hit the enemy. You don't have to do something specific. So for instance, you have a minor node called Greed, and this increases your damage as long as you continue to land light attacks. Then you have Keen Edge, which gives a flat critical damage increase. And then you have some insanely powerful skills that dish out large amounts of damage if they manage to land. So you take all of this damage and you pair it with a movement skill like Charge and Executioner's Speed, and you have a killer weapon that makes leveling an endgame much easier. Now let's talk about the last weapon on the S tier list. And this one may or may not be a controversial one depending on how you look at it. But let's talk about the Life Staff. So why is the Life Staff S tier? Well, for me, the Life Staff just brings so much value to soloing and to group play. It's really hard not to place it so high up. Now, hear me out, right? Because you're like, well, the damage isn't there. Of course the damage isn't there. But the Life Staff is the only weapon in the game that can heal you in multiple ways, right? Other weapons have healing as like a passive or a side effect of a condition being met. Like if you reap, you'll heal for the damage. If you have the Warhammer, you'll do like an AoE or a skill and that'll heal you for the damage, or you have Berserk. So you have all of these side effect ways to heal. The Life Staff is 100% healing. And when you're leveling, this weapon is fantastic to have as a secondary tool to save you from a quick death. You can grant yourself fortify, recovery, healing over time. You can drop an AoE heal that also regenerates mana, and then you're also helping other players around you. So it's just a great weapon. I mean, I can't tell you how many times in PvP and PvE that I've whipped out the Life Staff to either save myself or others from being killed. So then the question becomes, would this weapon be as good if the Void Gauntlet was in game, or if there was another healing mechanic? Maybe, maybe not. But we know right now is that this weapon is the only way to fulfill a specific need, and because of that, it's truly untouchable by other weapons. So let's move into A tier. So A tier weapons are not as quite as well-rounded as the S tier weapons. They're still amazing ones to use, to consider. And that's one thing I definitely want to cover really quick. The gap between S, A, and B weapons overall is pretty small. I mean, you can use any of these, have a marvelous time, get through the entire game. It's not like you're going to hamstring yourself completely, but there are minor differences that do separate each tier from the rest. So let's move into our first A-ranked weapon, and that is the Sword and Shield. So the Sword and Shield, like the Life Staff, is truly one of a kind in New World. No other weapon can be used with the shield, and no other combo has such a high focus on defense and group buffs than the Sword and Shield. You have a choice of Swordmaster or the Defender trees, each of which serve very unique purposes. The Swordmaster is all about increasing your damage, debuffing enemies, and buffing yourself and others, while the Defender tree is the de facto tanking tree that gives big buffs to your defense and protecting others. And that's especially true with the final node called Defensive Formation that reduces all damage to allies by 30% while you're blocking. I mean, this is such a powerful passive for dungeons, for PvP, because it has a small 1 second cooldown that you have to adhere to. And like the Life Staff, this combo is unique. No other weapon comes close. So that's why it's listed as an A. Next up, I want to talk a little bit about the Spear. So this weapon is fantastic. It has both utility and it has speed of attack. It comes with the ability to inflict bleeds, knockdowns. It's awesome at keeping enemies at a distance. And since you can throw it, it's great from attacking at range. Now, the spear comes with two trees, the zoner and the impaler, and each one operates pretty differently. So the zoner is all about knockdowns, increasing damage to knockdown enemies, and getting some big damage boosts off of full stamina. The Impaler focuses on bleeds, rends, and debuffs. Now, the final node here will give us a big damage boost depending on how many debuffs an enemy has. And this can pair with other weapons too. So this is why, for instance, the spear pairs so well with the bow or the musket, because you can load up the enemy on debuffs. So by the time they get to you, you'll have that nice plus 30% damage boost. Then you'll be able to clean them up pretty quickly. And on top of all of this, guys, the spear is extremely easy to use, which makes it perfect for beginners. Now, the one downside here for the whole kind of spear thing is that this deals less damage than DPS competitors like the hatchet or the rapier. So that's something to keep in mind. Now, is it enough to not consider it? Not really, but it is something you might notice if someone else is killing something and you seem to be killing things a little bit slower. Also, side note, we should really be able to use the spear with the shield. I mean, we see enemies use it in the game, and it just seems like such a cool thing to be able to take advantage of. Hopefully we'll see that maybe in a future content patch, but for now, the spear is purely a two-handed weapon. Now, let's go ahead and talk about one we just mentioned, and that is the musket. So the musket itself is a very powerful weapon, but the biggest downside is the fact that you are not mobile at all. You have zero mobility, essentially, as a musket user. And in a game like New World, where mobility is often a deciding factor in PvP and PvE battles, the musket loses effectiveness. Now, if you can set up shop and just sit in the back laying pot shots on enemies, the musket is one of the highest damaging weapons in the game, and that is truly what saves it. Because you're able just to really deny enemies from using cannons, from using repeaters, all of those things in PvP, and that makes it really, really powerful. And to top all that off, the musket does have some of the more interesting abilities in the game. You have a sticky bomb, which allows you to stick a bomb that explodes and then deals fire damage to enemies. You can lay down traps that will gain additional debuffs if an enemy runs into them. You have incendiary and powerful shots. So really, there's just a lot you can do with the musket. And overall, the only thing that's really holding it back from being an S-tier weapon is the fact that its mobility is basically zero. So lastly, let's talk about the rapier. So the rapier is another very unique weapon. And I say that because this weapon has the highest skill cap in the game, in my opinion. A really bad player will be very bad with the rapier and have low damage. You'll die all the time and it just won't work well. Overall, it's low performance. But in the hands of a really good player, the rapier will outperform almost any other weapon in the game in terms of damage. That's how good it is. And this is all derived from the two trees that you can take. So on one tree, you can focus on bleeds and then take advantage of those bleeds to deal extra damage. The other tree is all about movement and dodging and exposing your enemy. You have things like dodge attacks, you have shifting to the side, you have Fleche, which allows you to kind of pierce through a variety of enemies, and all of these things can proc different buffs. Now, the general consensus, don't take the bleed tree at all, focus entirely on the grace tree, because you're going to be able to really deal some significant damage and almost never get hit if you use all of your abilities correctly. So the rapier just in general focuses on high crit, high damage, but because it deals thrust damage, you also don't have a huge area where you can deal that damage, right? Most of it's going to come in the form of simple thrust directly to the enemies in front of you, which is where a lot of the skill comes in. You can dodge, move around, do all that, use all your different skills, but if you can't hit the thing in front of you or position yourself effectively, the rapier is not going to be a very good weapon for you. So that's something to keep in mind, and that is why this is an A tier weapon and not an S tier weapon. Honestly, the rapier could either be a complete D tier weapon where it's just terrible, or an S tier. It all depends on who is using it and how effective that player is. Okay, so that wraps up the A tier weapons. Let's talk about B tier. So these are weapons that either lose to a similar weapon type. Like, we're going to talk about the Warhammer versus the Great Axe, right? The Great Axe wins out there. So those are two similar typed weapons. One loses, one wins. Or weapons that aren't effective in a certain portion of the game, or they're just not effective enough as a whole. Now, this is the last tier. I didn't do a C and a D because truly no weapon in New World right now, in my opinion, is so bad that you should avoid using it at all costs, which is where I qualify C and D weapons. B tier is bottom of the barrel. Everything's fairly balanced, which it should be considering all of the different tests and data that they have. Now we'll see how this changes over time as new content comes out, new weapons get introduced, like the blunderbuss, daggers, claymore, void gauntlet, pistol. All of those things are coming, and that's going to shake this tier list up quite a bit. But for now, let's talk about what we have access to. So the first B tier weapon is the fire staff. Now, the fire staff is pretty weak early on, which is what drops it all the way down to the B tier. This one really opens up once you hit level 35. I mean, it jumps from probably a B tier to an A tier at that point. It becomes incredibly powerful. Its abilities will completely nuke enemies into nothing. It'll inflict burns to enemies, dealing damage over time. And you also have skills like Burnout, which are great for mobility, allows you to move around quickly, especially in PvP. So there's a lot that's packed into this particular weapon, but the damage is just so low early on, and then it scales really well with intelligence. So you go out and you get a bunch of intelligence focused gear, you start packing on a bunch of different perks to make your abilities do additional things, and suddenly the fire staff is an amazing weapon to use. So in terms of skill trees, both weapon trees will focus on fire damage and output. But there is one particular skill that you need to know about, and that's the Rune of Helios. Now, this is the final node on the Fire Mage tree. This one is really, really cool. So as long as you cast a fire spell, it's going to place a rune on the ground. And as long as you stay in that rune, you're going to deal 30% increased damage. The rune lasts for 7 seconds, and it has a 30-second cooldown, but the damage is there. And this is something that's really, really cool. I see a lot of people take advantage of this, and they just completely destroy enemies. So really cool stuff. Now, the only downside to the fire staff is for how long it takes to become good. I mean, we just talked about this, right? Use it in early game, you're gonna have a relatively bad experience. You might never use it again. But once you actually have a good staff, you can start making big investments into what that staff needs, then you're gonna have a great time and you're gonna be able to push out big amounts of damage. So let's talk about the next weapon, and that's the bow. So one of the biggest questions I see in chat pretty often is, should I go bow or musket? I mean, both use ammunition, both attack from a range, and both are good in certain situations, but which one's better? So in my eyes, the bow edges out the musket in mobility and versatility, right? Now, the musket is fantastic at long range battles or fights where you can stand still and just blow things up. Like we mentioned, if you're trying to pick off players who are on cannons or repeaters during a siege, then the musket works flawlessly. But if you're in the midst of combat or you get jumped by an enemy, the bow is better suited. I mean, it's just a better weapon for close quarters combat, mid-range combat. It has abilities like Poison Arrow for area denial. It has Evade Shot to give you some space. You gain damage increases when you dodge. And then you have like huge damage boosts to opening shots. And all of this make for a very strong case for the bow. But because the musket deals considerably more damage than the bow in the hands of a skilled player, the bow takes a B, the musket takes an A. But like I mentioned at the very beginning of this video, these are interchangeable in terms of enjoyment, right? If you really want to play the bow. You're not going to have a horrible time with it. If you really want to play the musket, have the musket. This is just my personal opinion and my personal experience. So let's move into the next weapon, and that one is the Ice Gauntlet. So the Ice Gauntlet was the final magic weapon added to the game before launch, and it has a lot of stuff packed into it. So this weapon is split into two trees, like every other weapon. You have the Builder and the Tempest. So the Tempest is all about creating different ice spells. You can send out big ice spikes, you can drop an ice storm that's gonna slow and freeze enemies, and you can drop an ice shower that comes crashing down on enemies to apply frostbite. So there's just a lot packed into this. So if you're like a frost mage, the gauntlet is definitely the way to go. You're gonna have a great time with that. Now the other tree is all about summoning this ice pylon. It's gonna do a bunch of damage for you. And just like Berserk for the hatchet, this ice pylon has nodes that span the entire tree all the way from top to bottom. So you can continue spending your points and just reinvesting into that ice pylon to give it more damage, more health, a bigger area. So there's just a lot of ways that you can go and customize that particular skill. And that's nice, right? But one of the key skills in the builder tree is called Ice Tomb. And this allows you to freeze yourself in place in a shield of ice. This will also supercharge your mana regeneration, give you a break from combat to refresh your health, and just essentially let you hit pause, which is great. A lot of healers use this. They pair it up with the life staff because you can burn through your mana and then you can pop Ice Tomb. You can get all of your mana back or a considerable portion of it and then get back into the fight. So it creates almost like an evocation style spell for mages in World of Warcraft. Now, the only downside here to the Ice Tomb in particular is that you can still be attacked and they can break you out of that Ice Tomb. So don't just like pop it, walk away from the keyboard and then come back expecting to be okay. You need to still stay there, stay engaged, because this isn't like a one-click invincibility button. Another thing I did want to note about this is that both trees will allow you to regain mana on attacks and skills. And they'll also give you some pretty big bonuses if you use frost-based attacks when you're standing in your frosted zones. Now your frosted zones appear when you use something like an ice storm or a frost pylon. These will just show up. If you stand in there, you'll gain nice bonuses and it just creates this overall experience. So compared to the other magic weapons, this one is my favorite aesthetically. I think the Ice Gauntlet looks the best. It sounds the best. It just has an overall look and feel that just is solid. It's very strong. But in terms of damage output, Fire Staff 100%. You're going to out DPS typically Ice Gauntlet users most of the time, because Ice Gauntlet doesn't really focus on damage. It focuses on control and utility. So let's go ahead and move on to our last weapon, and that is the Warhammer. So this is the other two-handed mauling weapon. It has a lot of interesting abilities, and both trees are split into two distinct roles. So one called the Crowd Crusher is all about tanking and controlling the crowd. This has skills that allow you to push back enemies, drop an AoE taunt, dish out some linear attacks, and regenerate health whenever you use a Crowd Crusher ability, which is one super helpful. The other tree is all about shattering armor and dealing big damage and applying debuffs to single or small groups of enemies. Now, when it comes to the other two-hander, right, the Great Axe, the Warhammer definitely takes the backseat. I mean, the Great Axe just puts out so much damage and has so much utility, it overshadows this weapon completely in terms of combat effectiveness. But in my opinion, if you want to pair a weapon with your sword and shield to like tank or just pull aggro, the Warhammer comes out on top over the Great Axe 100%. I mean, yes, you do have gravity wells, you have the reap that pulls enemies towards you, so the Great Axe does have some useful abilities. But the Warhammer, in my opinion, gives you that health recovery, has much better AoE taunts, and has better crowd control mechanics, which is what you want, especially if you're tanking and you're going through different dungeons. So at the end of the day, that is truly where this weapon in particular comes out and really shows off. Outside of that, It's definitely a solid B. Hopefully they give it some more love in the future, but for now, it is one of the bottom tier weapons, as bottom as you can be. All right, folks, that wraps this one up. So I want to know, what do you think of the tier list? Do you have a specific weapon that you would rate higher or lower? Do you think this is completely out of whack? I want to hear from everyone, so please drop a comment below. And I just gotta say, thank you so much for the 70K subscribers. That was phenomenal. This whole New World launch has been incredible. The support has been overwhelming, to be honest. And I just really appreciate it. So I wanted to make sure to put that out there. We're having a really good time. And this has been such a fun experience. So thank you. Thank you very much, truly. So that wraps this one up. This has been Vulcan, and I'll see you guys on the next one.